A very warm welcome to all of you to this extremely important occasion for all of us at the Center for the Study of Developing Societies. I'm pretty obsessed with Ashokan edicts these days, and I cannot but begin with one of those edicts. Both Shelley and Romola and many others here would remember that in one of the edicts, Ashoka, giving advice to all the followers of different paths, Pashandas, the edict says, or Ashoka says, don't praise yourself unless you have good reason to. But even if you have good reason to, do so only if the occasion is appropriate. But even when the occasion is appropriate, do so moderately, never immoderately. I think since this is the 50th year of CSDS, it is the right occasion to praise oneself. And I hope very much that I have some good reasons to praise CSDS, and I very much hope that I shall do so moderately, although that I cannot guarantee. That is up to the audience to judge. I think it's quite clear that no institution can perform at the very highest level, meet the highest standards of excellence, and achieve the very best that can be achieved on a permanent basis. I mean, it's next to impossible. But a great institution, in my view, or a really good institution, in my view, is one that has the ability to pick itself up every time it falls or falters. And we know, those who have been in CSDS, as well as those who have not been in CSDS, who have watched CSDS from outside, they know that we have fallen a few times. But I think we have picked ourselves up, and picked ourselves up pretty well. We have attracted new scholars. We have produced works of great ambition, as well as painstaking scholarship. We've broken disciplinary boundaries. We have consistently remained methodologically pluralist, being simultaneously empirical, ethnographic, phenomenological, and theoretical. We have explored, or tried to explore, new grounds. We have questioned received categories, either from Western social science or from so-called indigenous knowledge systems. In other words, we have fought, if not always successfully, cultural subjugation of a certain kind, as well as intellectual subjection. We've encouraged diversity of thought. We have tried to give due weightage to individual needs and to collective institutional aspirations. We built new publics. And we've had the imagination not to think of ourselves only as, you know, as Indians, but always thought of ourselves as part of a, if not a global imagination, at least a truly subcontinental South Asian imagination, and increasingly as part of the what is called the Global South. But perhaps the most important thing about us is that institutions, and this is not something new, I wrote this in a little piece in the seminar, that institutions in India fail to retain the fundamental vision that first animated them. And they begin to flounder with the departure of their founders. They neither die nor survive. They live in a limbo. And therefore, it is deeply satisfying. And this, I can assure you, is a moderate term. I could have said something, but it's deeply satisfying that CSDS, in its 50th year, continues to live with a profound purpose. And it is a testimony to that we have someone like Shelley Pollock here and a huge number of people sitting here on this occasion coming to listen to him. Now, Ashokini, this, you might recall, spoke of the importance of moderation in criticizing others and in praising oneself. But I don't think he had very much to say, or the edicts had much to say, about praising others. So I'm now free to praise Sheldon Pollock to the point of embarrassment. I think he can be embarrassed, but I will nonetheless praise him. There are no such restraints, right? I mean, I'm still kind of following the Ashokan edict, so no such restraints exist as far as I can remember. I mean, you know, Ramila is sitting here and Shelley too, but I think there aren't any such as restraints on praising other people. So I can say shamelessly that Shelley is among a handful of scholars who, through an imaginative, rigorous, and scrupulous reading of texts, and not just a reading of texts, but with a profound theoretical understanding of how texts are to be read in Sanskrit or Prakrit or Pali, he's given us, all of us, an access to an entire world which would have remained buried. So he's helped to kind of dredge up a whole lot of intellectual treasure back to the surface. He has dusted all that. And he has enabled us to reconsider what we now think of it. I don't think it would be immoderate to say that at one point he was attempting to do it virtually single-handedly. And the reason why he is not doing this all by himself today is because he has managed to create, many of them might be sitting here, but he managed to create a whole generation of students who have followed his example and who have taken his methodological and his substantive insight seriously and are busy taking the whole project forward. I shall soon talk about that in a minute, because there is a whole winter school taking place at the center, which is inspired by his work and by his example. There is more to Shelley. He is, you can say, one of the founders of a new critical philology. He's changed, you know, he's changed the meaning of philology. For a lot of us, perhaps even today, philology was a term of abuse. It was a defunct discipline. It connoted a dull and narrow method of studying classical European antiquity through rather boring texts. I think he's completely changed all that by giving us a sense of what philology is, representing a new theory of reading texts, introducing into it a critical dimension, but even more importantly, putting it in a comparative perspective and made it genuinely global so that you can say without any inhibitions that a lot of great philology and philological text or the history of philology lies in India, in China, in other parts of the world. And not just in Europe. As I said, through the imagination, but rigorous reading of texts, and if I may say so, text analogues, he's helped us to see the multiple ways in which, say, the imperial political principle was realized in both Europe and India. I'm thinking of his work on axialism and empire. And therefore to enabled us to have a better grasp of the alternative possibilities of realizing trans-regional polities. By his own reckoning, he studies past in a way that is, I can't remember where he took this from. Not maybe it's his own term, but he studies past in a way that is actionable history, which is, and I quote, I think, maybe I paraphrase it, it's an attempt to produce statements about the past, about past events that can inform the conduct of present practices. And here, you shouldn't mistake me, you know, this is not some shallow presentism. The contemporary concerns are there. And so the text that he studies and through which he opens up different worlds, these texts speak to us. But these texts of the past are not contemporary texts. The interesting thing about it is that the distance and the unfamiliarity and the strangeness of the text of the past is retained. And it's very clear that though all the contemporary texts speak to us today in some way, in the same way as those other texts speak to us today, there is a huge difference between them. There is a lot of mistake that people used to make when I was a student at Oxford in the early 70s, when, you know, people like Gilbert Ryle would say, anything that you study on Plato could well have been should be read as if it was published in the mind last month. And that's a very different way of reading texts and making them speak to you, because the whole interesting difference between what texts are today and how they speak to us today and what texts are in the past and how they speak to us from the past, that distance is entirely collapsed. And Shelley, of course, has never done that. There is a past which must make a compelling demand on us, and that obligation to meet the demand must remain, and the magic is somehow to keep that distance and yet make them speak to us as if they are for us. And Shelley has done that, and I'm sure those who follow him have done that too. I can't help making one last remark, and this is from Nietzsche. I think he quite values some of the things that Nietzsche says. Nietzsche says, and I think he would agree with this. I don't know if I've read only a couple of articles by Shelley, and this is an occasion for me to actually become more closely reading a whole lot of stuff that he had written. But Nietzsche says, I can't imagine what would be the meaning of classical philology in our own age if it is not to be untimely. That is to say, to act against the age. And by so doing, to have an effect on our age. And then he adds something which is very affirmative and very different from what many people might think of Nietzsche. And he says, and let us hope to the benefit of a future age. That's very important. And I think in the way that I see this actionable history, his Gadamerian understanding of how to appropriate texts is very much in line with and in keeping with this very profound statement that is made by Nietzsche about how philology has to be untimely, how it must act against the age, and yet in the same breath be beneficial for our age. I said that Shelley has inspired a lot of students, but he's not only inspired a lot of students, he's actually inspired a whole the setting up of a whole school. Currently, there's a winter school being held in collaboration with the CSDS. It's called, forgive my German, but maybe I can pronounce it correctly. It's called Zukunftsphilologie. Is that correct? More or less correct. Okay. The German for Future Philology, which was set up in Berlin, and many of the students and many of the commanders of that school, like Islam, are still here. One of them, George, left yesterday. They're all here, and are here because they are students of Shelley in some ways. They followed his example, and And they hope to carry some of the work that he's done in the same critical spirit that Sherry has done his own work. With those remarks about CSTS, the praise, which was moderate, I hope, and the I won't say eulogy, but that's at least the praise, which was hopefully not that moderate. With those remarks, I once again welcome all of you and invite Sherry to give what turns out to be the first Golden Jubilee lecture in this in the series of Golden Jubilee lectures which we have to mark this very important occasion of the 50 years of CSTS. So Sherry, the floor is all yours.